Hello, my name is Robin Kim, and I'm a second year PhD student at the University of Virginia's Department of Engineering Systems and Environment. I will be presenting my work on mapping permafrost donation using three major sources of satellite-based Earth observations. Before I begin, I would like to thank AGU and NASA for this opportunity, my advisor, Dr. Venkat Lakshmi and Dr. Hari Rajaram, and collaborators within NASA's High Mountain Asia team. For visual context, the background image shown here is a scene near Gosainkunda, a holy lake in Langtang National Park in Nepal. Permafrost is traditionally defined as ground that has been frozen for at least 2 years and is estimated to cover about 10% of the global land surface. And in the Arctic alone, permafrost soils are estimated to store more than 1.5 trillion tons of carbon, or twice that of the entire atmosphere. Therefore, accurate maps and more precise surveys of permafrost are necessary to better quantify the projected consequences of warming and eventual permafrost thaw due to climate change. The most recent global mapping effort is shown here, developed by Steven Gruber in 2012, and is based on modeled air temperatures from 1961 to 1990, and assumes empirical normal distribution relationships between mean annual air and mean annual ground temperatures. A permafrost zonation index typically categorizes permafrost regions into isolated, sporadic, discontinuous, and continuous zones, which are defined by the probability or likelihood that permafrost exists at a given location. However, studies specific to the High Mountain Asia region are limited and difficult to pursue due to geographic challenges. Known as both the third pole and the rooftop of the world, this region is characterized by high altitudes and rugged terrains. As you can tell from the cycling scene showcasing the Himalayas, specifically Amadablam, Pamirs, specifically Ak Baital Pass, and Tibetan Plateau, specifically Lake Manasarovar. As well as this map derived from MERIT-DEA, a dataset that leverages the best of the Shuttle Radar Topography mission under NASA and the Advanced Land Observation Satellite under JAXA. Major regions of High Mountain Asia are highlighted: the Tian Shan, Pamirs, Karakoram, Hindu Kush, Himalayas, Hengduan, and finally the Tibetan Plateau. Interest in researching High Mountain Asia's cryosphere has grown exponentially in recent years, as watersheds in this region affect more than a billion people downstream in the form of landslide risk, freshwater storage, and infrastructure. However, while glaciers can be observed through optical means, permafrost extent is more difficult to estimate as it is a subsurface feature. And so I attempted to map areas of permafrost using land surface temperatures remotely sensed by Terra and Aquamotus, or moderate resolution imaging spectroradiometers. These instruments can detect brightness temperatures in the thermal infrared bands and have become important tools for monitoring land atmosphere interactions. The goal was to use mean annual land surface temperature from 2003 to 2016 to estimate where permafrost is most likely to exist. The graphs in the far right panels show the spatial averages of the subdivided regions in the form of a time series. While warming is not obvious regionally, the histogram shows a marginal shift to the right as it approaches year 2016. The panels in the lower left are example transects and inset maps showing the mean annual land surface temperature of the different subregions. However, as stated before, glaciers are common as well. Permanent snow and ice cover prevents an accurate reading of land surface temperature, especially where snow cover is persistent, because snow depth has an insulating effect on the ground. Thus, I used mean snow depth estimates generated by Liu, Feng, and Margulis, specific to the High Mountain Asia region that was produced in 2021 to correct the land surface temperature averages at a monthly time step. Their dataset was an ensemble product based on fractional snow cover data from MODIS and the Landsat series, as well as meteorological forcing data from MERIT-2 or modern era retrospective analysis for research and applications. We can see when and where snow accumulates or depletes over the course of a year based on these monthly time series. Again, the far right panels show the mean monthly snow depth estimates for each subregion's transect. Some of the deepest snow is present in the Himalayas and Karakoram, while the Tibetan Plateau averages below even a tenth of a meter annually. After using a modified snow depth correcting equation for ground temperature originally derived by a pair of scientists, Smith and Riseborough in 2002, I was able to obtain land surface temperatures suitable for estimating permafrost extent. The cumulative distribution function presented in the bottom right is plotted in the upper right, in which lower temperatures are associated with a greater likelihood of permafrost extent, and higher temperatures with lower likelihoods. The middle right plot shows a histogram and cumulative frequency at which permafrost, based on the four zones, is present according to elevation. And to be specific, isolated accounts for permafrost extents below 10%, sporadic accounts for permafrost extents between 10 to 50%, and discontinuous accounts for 50 to 90%, and continuous permafrost zones account for permafrost extents above 90%. The transects below show agreement between areas where lower ground surface temperatures coincide with greater snow cover. While I have to emphasize that these are just estimates, this work will hopefully inform scientists about where permafrost is at most risk of thaw and help target areas for in-situ research on the ground. Thank you. If you'd like to connect or have any questions, please contact me by email shared on the title page. I'd like to again thank my advisors and research mates for morale and guidance, as well as these specific people for helping me with accessing the data. The images were taken from unsplash.com, and here is a list of citations used for this presentation as well.